Welcome to this teach-in on the Iraq War. I want to apologize for the fact that on relatively short notice we were unable to get one of the larger halls. Both Woolsey and Battelle were booked for this evening. So we're here. There's an overflow television broadcast in room 127, and I'm sorry that's the best we can do. I'm very heartened by the very large turnout. I think it's great that the Yale community is showing such a keen interest in such an important event in our lives. War, as I'm sure Don Kagan will point out sometime this evening, is the normal state of human affairs. If you look over the long sweep of history, even what we call civilized societies have been at war far more than at peace. And yet for us, for those of you who are students, and even for some of us who are, you know, younger faculty, most of our lives, in the United States at least, has been during times of peace. So war appears shocking, traumatic, anomalous, and of course it is all those things. It is also tragic, and it costs lives, and it disrupts lives on all sides of combat, on the sides of all combatants. It's a phenomenon that we need to understand. We live in an intellectual, educational community that values the opportunity for inquiry. This is a time for us to try to understand the reasons for what is transpiring in Iraq, the likely prospects for the future of Iraq and its region, what is the proper role of the United States in such a conflict, and what should the proper role be of the United States and its allies going forward. These are not easy questions, these are hard questions. And the community is divided in its opinion on these matters. The latest tabulation on the Yale Daily News poll shows the student body split almost down the middle in terms of support for and opposition to the current war effort. That's why events such as this are so valuable. It's an opportunity for us to lay aside our prejudices and open up our minds and hear from distinguished experts who will at least initiate the discussion. They're not going to tell you what to think, but they will ask the kinds of questions and make the kinds of observations that I hope will cause you all to think for yourselves. That's the point of a Yale education. That's why we're here. And I'm sure that it will be an evening that will be helpful to us all. That's the end of my role this evening. I'm glad you're here. I'm going to turn the panel over to our distinguished historian of the Cold War, Professor John Lewis Gaddis, who will moderate this evening's discussion. Thank you.
Thanks very much, President Levin, and thanks to you for initiating the idea for this discussion. I think it'll be very helpful to all of us. I was reminded of how much time has passed since our generation was concerned with some of these kinds of things when a student came in this afternoon and asked, "Professor Gaddis, could you explain what a teach-in is?" This is a teach-in, ladies and gentlemen. It is a revival of a tradition that began with the Vietnam War and has continued sporadically ever since when controversial issues of this kind have confronted this country. So it's hardly surprising that this controversial issue would generate this kind of FM. So thanks for coming. I want to introduce our distinguished panelists. I think I will follow the following speaking order. I think I will start first with Professor Ellen Lust-Okar of the Political Science Department, to be followed by Professor Charles Hill of the Political Science Department as well, and DS and IS and ISS and GS. He has a lot of initials that he's affiliated with. Ellen and Charlie both have particular expertise in the region that we're talking about in the Middle East, so it seems to me logical to start with them. And then we will go to a couple of well-known professors who will give us a broader perspective, though I predict from opposite ends of the spectrum, Professor Kennedy and Professor Kagan, colleagues of mine in the history department. That will be the order of proceeding this evening. I've asked each of the panelists to speak for no more than 5 to 6 minutes. I've asked them to reflect particularly on the events of the last week. What has surprised them? What has not surprised them? What do we know now that we didn't know a week ago? And what are the larger implications of what we know at this point and where this might be pointing us in the future? That's a lot to address in 5 minutes, but they will also have an opportunity to respond to each other, and of course the main event this evening is their opportunity to respond to questions and comments from you, and we will surely build in enough time for that. So with no further delay, let me invite Ellen Lust-Okar, if you would, to start, please. Thanks.
And in truth, in advertising, I'm going to talk less about the events of last week than what I thought was sort of the lessons, in a sense, from last week. My understanding of thinking about what was particularly striking to me was to think about the current war, what I tend to call it the Gulf War, as opposed to the war on Iraq, despite sort of CNN titles. And the differences between that and the first Gulf War of 1990 and 91. There are several things, of course, that we've known for a long time, right? There's been a lot of talk about the different levels of international support, the extent to which that was a broad coalition, and what we have today is a relatively narrow coalition, and particularly the lack of overt support in the region itself. And again, there the most notable sort of factor is the inability to get Turkey to allow us to use sort of the northern front. There's also, of course, an incredibly different image about the U.S. and Iraq this time. In 1990, after the August 2nd invasion of Iraq into Kuwait, it was very clear who was the aggressor. There was no question in anyone's mind who was the aggressor and sort of who was, in a sense, going out as the good guy. This time, actually, that's not nearly so clear, and so you're getting a lot more discussion about U.S. aggression into the region, right? And so a real debate and sort of a struggle over the extent to which the U.S. versus Iraq is the aggressor, who's the aggressor, who's the victim, and of course, in regards to that, a decreased level of support internationally, particularly I just came back from Europe, and it's very striking there, and a decreased support, of course, in the region, particularly among the Arab people. A couple of other things which, of course, we thought about them, or I'm sure many people have thought about them, become very clear in the last week. One of which, of course, is that this is not fighting in Kuwait. Rather, this is fighting in Iraq, and that's going to change the nature of the war itself. Right? There's a sort of a slight, it's probably strategic, and I'm not a strategian, so advantage to the Iraqis of being able to fight, in a sense, on their own turf. But more importantly, it's really clear that the Iraqis essentially are sort of fighting for their lives. Or at least the regime is clearly fighting for its life. And that's going to make a large difference. And there, I think, it's important to keep in mind sort of what the regime and what those who are supporting either tacitly or overtly the regime end up thinking about. It's not necessarily, was this the best regime in the world? That's not the question. It's, is this regime better than the alternatives? Okay? And there, while the sort of the portrayal in the states is that the alternatives is the U.S. and democracy and peace and stability, it is not clear to those on the ground, at least so far, that it's not clear that that's necessarily what the alternatives are. Which is why sort of the today's sort of, strike in a residential area is particularly, in a sense, disturbing, partly because, of course, of the residential, of the deaths of civilians, but also because people say, is this what it means to have the U.S. here? That there's a notion and a certain recognition of what it meant to have sort of French and British powers coming into the region in the 20s through the 40s. So it's not clear to everyone in sort of even U.S. support or U.S. Sort of presence in the region would be a better alternative. And on top of that, of course, what's often held Iraq together has been the notion that Iraq is made up of sort of Shia, Kurdish, and Sunni areas, and it's not necessarily clear to everyone in that case that you're looking at a future that looks better. There, I think the important thing to keep in mind is that the sort of the threat of Turkish forces in the northern Iraq has again brought into question what does it mean if we have sort of lose the stability. So in this sense, I think it's important to recognize sort of the significance of things like Turkey and the question of the Kurds in Iraq. It's also important to realize that the question about whether or not Saddam is alive or dead, which of course we focus on quite a bit, is perhaps less important in the long run. That actually, interestingly enough, Syria is a great example of a regime that everyone thought sort of, when Hafez al-Assad dies, then all of a sudden the Syrian regime will be really unstable. Well, the truth was that those who had supported Hafez al-Assad had an interest in the regime writ large, not an interest in Hafez al-Assad, and I would argue there are certain factors that have an interest in the regime of the Iraqi regime, not an interest in Saddam Hussein. Finally, I wanted to sort of make a couple of comments on what I think are sort of really interesting different effects on the region itself. I noted earlier that this war is different than the previous because, of course, we'd had Arab allies, and a very overt Arab allies in the first war. That, of course, is not the case this time. More importantly, there are now sort of alternative messages. Okay, so it's not only an issue of having the state message or perhaps CNN or BBC. Now there are messages being broadcast from the region and from the media itself. And that's both Arab media, Al Jazeera, Abu Dhabi, and also sort of the international media sometimes filtered through or reflected on stations like Al Jazeera and Abu Dhabi. These stations have a legitimacy that the state-run stations didn't have previously and that CNN doesn't have currently. Okay, so in a sense, these stations have a counter message and actually a very, very different message than CNN. So for instance, yesterday there was discussions on CNN about the uprising in Basra and talking about how that was an uprising in support of Saddam Hussein. On Al Jazeera, there was a discussion about the uprisings in Basra talking about how those were in support of Saddam Hussein. I'm not arguing which is better. I'm just saying that right now we have two very different narratives going on. If you're listening to the Arab media or if you're listening to sort of especially the US media. And the other thing that's interesting is that, and it's also helping to increase the legitimacy of these stations, is that they're not only sort of discussing sort of the Arab positions on this, but they are also broadcasting again a French argument that, you know, U.S. democracy promotion is as it has been in sort of Haiti and Panama, for instance, or they're discussing the House of Commons opposition member was being translated into Al Jazeera yesterday, talking about the relationship between Sharon and Mubarak, which, of course, at a time when the Palestinian-Israeli crisis is sort of increasing and at a height, is a very sort of hot item be placing into the larger Arab arena at the moment, right? So in these ways, the struggle then, as it's being sort of portrayed on these media, is not simply one of the US and Iraq. It's becoming, in a sense, one of US and Western control over the region, and sometimes over the region through leaders like Mubarak, for instance, or through Abdullah II in Jordan, or through the Saudi regime. So it's drawing into question not only sort of the issues between the US and Iraq, but it's also drawing into question to some extent the legitimacy of these regimes themselves. And in those regards, we could talk about it later, but I would argue that Jordan is incredibly unstable at the moment, that Egypt is relatively unstable, and Saudi has certainly some difficulties. Also in that regard, it's interesting to take a look and see if I'm reasonably right, we should see that Friday will be an interesting day. It will be the first day of sort of after prayer services, and that tends to be a time of rallies that will have been sort of a week into the war. A final note. So in a sense, what I'm arguing is that this is not a war as it was in 1990 and 91, sort of in the region. This time it is, in a sense, a war for the region, okay? At least it's being perceived by many actors as that way. And the second thing to keep in mind is that a victory doesn't have to be sort of an all-out victory. As it was in sort of the 1973 Arab-Israeli conflict, when the Arabs claimed essentially victory by having fought off the Israelis and sort of succeeded and gone farther than they expected they can. To some extent, the ability to sort of see this as the Iraqi regime heading off the Americans and sort of this preponderance of US and Western power longer than we would expect them to be able to do so is going to be played in the region as essentially sort of a victory, or at least a limited victory against the West.
Thank you.
Early.
Well, I've been talking to friends today about the last week, talking on the telephone, and I thought I would just go over some of the points I've been making with those friends, but in perhaps less colorful language than I have been putting forward to them. the future of the international system, which is led by and is directed toward democratic societies, rests on the success of this war against Saddam Hussein. This war will soon be over. That will not be the end. In Winston Churchill's words, the end of the war, the end of this war, will be only the end of the beginning. The next set of tasks, which must be taken up at once, will be diplomatic. And if we do not succeed in these endeavors, then today's war in Iraq may be only a preface to a greater struggle, just as the Korean War was to the decades-long Cold War. Start with the United Nations. It has disgraced itself. A long time will pass before any serious international security issue will be put before it. But as the role of the Security Council has dwindled over the years, the social, humanitarian, and economic functions of the UN have gained some respect. As the United States shoulders the initial job of restructuring Iraq, we should start discussions immediately on phasing the UN into the work of administering free elections and other peace-building work that we know from experience the UN can do well. We should also immediately be in consultations with the Arab League. The UN Charter's Chapter 8 recognizes that regional organizations can contribute to matters of international peace and security, and the Arab League could be indispensable to the process of re-legitimizing Iraq as a state in good standing in the world. And in so doing, the Arab League can do much to help its other members transcend the deplorable social and political conditions detailed in the UN's Arab Human Development Report issued a year ago. We must also begin to clarify and stabilize the conditions of NATO, which remains in being as a collection of like-minded democracies with good military-to-military relationships, but which, thanks to the French, can no longer be considered a true alliance. Now our international security will have to be based on coalitions, not on the alliance. No longer can we count on the principle of all for one, one for all. It will be more like a sheriff's posse deciding who will go after the bad guys on a case-by-case basis, and NATO's place will be to serve partially as a pool of talent from which to draw now this, now that combination of the ready, willing, and able. Central to this diplomatic effort also is the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Only a state can deliver on its commitment to another state. And the negotiations between Israelis and Palestinians have not worked ever since the mid-1980s, when first Egypt and then Jordan dropped out of their role as the state partner across the negotiating table from Israel. Today, we have another new international grouping, I think potentially a very effective one, the so-called quartet of the United States, Russia, Europe, and the UN. And they have agreed upon a plan that could establish a Palestinian state soon, a state that could negotiate a peace treaty with the State of Israel. And here we see the international state system working, state to state, with bringing the Palestinian state, the new state of Palestine, into the UN and the international state system. And steps have begun by which the Palestinians can bring about the political, financial, and security steps needed to ensure that their new state will not be a failed state at birth. These are only a few of the institutions and functions of the international state system that require our urgent diplomatic attention. Since the end of the Cold War, all the elements of our international state system, which is the way the world works, those elements are, in part, the state itself as the fundamental entity of the system, international organizations like the UN, international law, norms of conduct, the requirement to maintain a professional military. All of these have been neglected, from within, and they have been attacked from without. In reality, the war on terrorism is really a war against the international system, just as the Cold War was. The enemies of our international system operate on two levels. There are the non-state terrorist groups, such as Al-Qaeda, driven by a revolutionary ideology, an ideology that would destroy the established international system in every aspect and replace it with Islamism. And then, on the other level, there are places like Iraq, where brutal gang lords have seized command of all central authority and are masquerading as states of the legitimate international system, aggrandizing their powers by claiming all the privileges and immunities of real states, which they are not, and Iraq is foremost among them. So the challenge is military, to defeat the terrorists and the rogue states on every front, and it is diplomatic, to repair and revitalize our international system, which is now under severe attack. Not since the years between the end of World War II and the opening of the Cold War have we faced such a dire challenge. And the consequences of this showdown may be even greater than were those of the earlier time. If, but only if, we act with urgency and, moreover, with solidarity, can we bring this war to a successful conclusion in far less time than it took to deal with the Cold War.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I bumped into Professor Gaddis today. I was leaving campus, he was heading in, and I said to him, "John, have you any idea what we're supposed to do this evening?" And he said, "No, but why don't you think of what might have surprised you or been rather remarkable to you in the past 5 days?" So as I walked back to Humphrey Street, I kept thinking to myself, well, what has surprised me? There was actually very little. Was I surprised that President Bush and his cabinet had not taken my wise advice that we could just contain Saddam Hussein and not necessarily go to war against him, contain him with many more inspectors and regimes? Well, actually, I wasn't too surprised that he hadn't taken my advice. Was I surprised by the news that there are sandstorms in the desert? Was I surprised by Iraq's counterattacks during sandstorms? Well, no, they live there. Was I surprised today by the sad news of civilian casualties and the beginnings of recrimination? Was it Allied aircraft or missile? Was it actually Iraqi secret police and that sort of stuff? No. Was I surprised by the lack of a real and instant uprising in Basra? Certainly not. Look at what happened to the Marsh Arabs in 1991, where they rose up and then we walked away from them, and Saddam slaughtered them. They'll rise up when the regime is 200 miles to the north, not sitting next door to it. Was I surprised by Halliburton getting the first contract for the reconstruction of this society? Well, quite frankly, I wasn't. Was I surprised by Mr. Rumsfeld announcing every day fresh recruits to the coalition of the willing? You may, those of you in favor of this swift action and decisive victory, must have been so encouraged yesterday by the news that the coalition of the willing has been joined by Micronesia. Just the idea of the Gilbert and Ellis Islands Expeditionary Marine Corps is truly frightening. The Iraqis will surrender at once. There are only three actors in the military game. There's the Americans, the British, and the Iraqis. And it would be it would be less of an insult to our intelligence if the Defense Department stopped this coalition of the willing business. Am I surprised by the opening of a Northern Front? No, not at all. That's what air mobility is for. In fact, I'm still waiting for an opening of a Western Front. Why did we didn't just go to those mysterious airfields, H2 and H3, as a way of protecting Israel. There's about a couple of very heavy armored units which have suddenly disappeared from the map and haven't been mentioned in the past 5 or 6 days. Was I surprised by Monsieur Chirac's churly, resentful attitude? Well, no, because if you talk to his fellow politicians in French domestic politics, he's a bull in a china there, so why shouldn't he be a bull in a china shop in the Security Council? So what did surprise me? First, and I say this as somebody who's a great admirer of the American Constitution and system, and as President Level and Don Kagan will know, this is my 20th year of being at Yale. I'm surprised that the US Congress has been so incredibly supine. I just can't believe that in the age of Senator Fulbright, or in the age of the great arch-conservative Republican Senator Vandenberg, there would not have been much more insistent questioning. And I don't care whether the questioning is in secret or open. In fact, I'd rather prefer it to be in secret. But this, here's a Congress which passes resolutions about freedom fries, for God's sake. It has a job. The Senate Foreign Relations Committee has a job. The House Armed Services Committee has a job, and it's not really doing it. The second thing that surprises me, perhaps it shouldn't, but I've only been here 20 years, is that the US public should, according to the opinion polls, have been so rosy and optimistic before last weekend, as if this war was a video arcade war where you just saw zings and wings and flashes, that they expected to win without casualties, without nastiness, without wartime atrocities, without prisoners of war, without missing in action. Tell me a war when we didn't have that. We will win. I don't think there's any doubt about that, but there are various costs, and I wonder about them. The collateral damage, ladies and gentlemen, is not just the house next door to the military barracks getting damaged. The damage to NATO, perhaps. The damage to the viability and authority of the Security Council. What will happen when the next significant international crisis of stability, be it Kashmir, be it the collapse of Venezuela, be it North Korea, comes along and the Security Council is asked by some of the United Nations members to try to handle it? It's in a pretty fractured state now, and there's a number of people responsible for that. And what will be the long-term relationship of the US to the Arab world, a relationship which 40, 50 years ago was actually a rather favorable one, a benevolent one, and now clearly is not. So I'm not surprised by too much, Professor Gaddis, but I'm surprised by a couple of things. Thank you.
Professor.
Well, I am surprised by one thing, surprised out of my wits. I've listened to my colleagues speak, and I have not heard anything that bothers me very much. And I must be getting old or something. But I've heard mostly, almost everything that's been said is common sense and I think well-founded. I'm a little bit surprised at Kennedy's surprise. That is to say, the sort of ill-informed and naive reaction of the American people to what they thought was going to happen. They're always like that. You're just not old enough. I remember the Gulf War of 91, the run-up to that, the media were filled, well, first of all, 46 senators, I think every one of them was a Democrat, opposed giving President Bush the power to use force, if necessary, against Saddam Hussein. So the situation was rather different in that respect, too. But secondly, the media were filled with experts telling us what was going to happen. They were practically unanimous, left and right, military and non-military. Senator Kennedy took the lead by telling us that we were going to have body bags in the tens of thousands. This was being supported by the folks I've been talking about. And the American people, I think, were prepared for that. And then when the war, or the semi-war, or the half-war, whatever you want to call it, took 100 hours and it was over, everybody was quite astonished. So much depends about what the American people think, because they don't think about these things until the last minute. And what they think is what the media are projecting. So I think I'm surprised you're surprised, because you're a very savvy man. My observations will not teach you very much, but I'll share them with you. I'm convinced, as I was before the war, that this was going to be a much tougher war for many of the reasons that people have said. Among those reasons, one that I would add would be that the United States, for political reasons, both domestic and foreign, which may indeed be compelling, nonetheless, is fighting this war with a couple of hands tied behind its back. It's desperately concerned to see to it that nobody gets killed. And that's a highly admirable position to take, but it's not a very easy way to fight a war. I mean, it's bad if Americans get killed, it's bad if civilians get killed, and it will turn out even to be bad if Iraqi soldiers get killed, because the prospect of killing more Iraqi soldiers frightened General Powell into quitting the war the last time. But that is, I think, a fact that we have to understand. America will not allow itself to use the fullness of whatever military power it has because of these other concerns, and that's a fact. But the war will be tough for many reasons beyond that, as my colleagues have pointed out. I think there was no reason to expect a quick or easy surrender on the part of the Iraqis for the many reasons that have been said before, but I think it's important to realize that it's probably true that most Iraqis hate Saddam Hussein. But there's no reason to doubt that most Iraqis hate the United States. And history teaches me that when attacked for whatever reason by an outsider, nations and people tend to pull together with their fellow nationals as their first instinct, and it takes quite a lot to shake them loose. 20th century has seen far too much expectation that sheer military power and the evidence of how overwhelming it is and how small is the chance of resisting it will cow the people that you're attacking into a surrender. It hardly ever happens. And so I think that I'm not surprised that that hasn't happened quickly, in my opinion. And I think that the Defense Department has made a serious mistake in the early days. I don't know if they stopped it yet, but basically leading the Americans to believe that pretty soon these guys are going to see reason and they're going to quit. Because even if they believed it, it was unwise to say it, because you never can know and you just look like a damn fool if it doesn't happen. But of course, they should have known that that was a highly problematical suggestion. There will probably be considerable surrenders by the end of the war, but that will not happen until the war has been won militarily. And everybody is confident that this regime has been defeated and will be out of there. And then people will probably not be insane and insist upon being killed, but will surrender. But I think that's what has to be done. There has to be a military victory for this to come to an end. Now, I think that, I was surprised by one thing, and that was the speed of the advance by the American forces. Partly, it was because I couldn't know in advance for sure what Saddam would do in terms of how to handle that. He chose not to make any very serious resistance, which was probably a good idea, but I couldn't be sure that was going to happen. And I didn't know that the Americans would, in fact, go racing forward so quickly and choose not to finish off Basra and that sort of thing. In fact, I sat there scratching my head as they ran by Basra. This was the British, of course, mainly, but part of the coalition. But I said, you know, why are they doing that? Why aren't they taking Basra before they go somewhere else? Well, I'm sure there are reasons that can readily be defended, but I was not certain how that would go and was surprised by that. I was not surprised, of course, by the success that these forces have had, and I think they have the degree to which they have run into trouble has been wildly exaggerated by the media. You can only regard their problems as serious if you thought that nobody was going to get killed and everybody would step aside and bow as we came trotting by. So I think there's no surprise about that. But I myself do not know how the battle for Baghdad will play out. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot one other thing. I was surprised that the Turks ultimately did not cooperate with the United States, even to the smallest degree. And I'll bet you any money the United States government was damn surprised about that. That's one of the reasons why America's forces aren't at more beefy than they are today with, the 4th Infantry Division that was supposed to come walking down from Turkey is in fact on a boat someplace heading for Kuwait, so that there will be some delay before those forces are added to these forces. But the Battle of Baghdad will be decisive. Before we get there, the question is how much damage will American air power and other forces have? How will it be able to decimate the powerful Republican Guard regiments that are in front of Baghdad? Will they be able to really take them out? If so, the Baghdad problem will be smaller. If not, it'll be harder. Once they start really fighting over Baghdad, there will, I think, inevitably be more civilian casualties, and all the problems that flow from that will happen. I think, in other words, we need to be prepared for an unpleasant war that will be longer than we have been prepared for, and that is something we should just look for. Just a final word on the points that my colleagues have made. They're absolutely right. Winning the war is an essential step to any hope for establishing some degree of stability in the Middle East, but it's only the first step. Very hard steps will have to follow. The United States, and one would hope the American people, and that's where so much depends upon the quality of our leadership in doing what leaders in a democracy must do to be satisfactory. They must be educators. They must be able to inform the American people in some honest and thoughtful way as to what the realities are out there, what will be required of us to achieve the goals that are being set forward, and get us ready. I don't think the American people, for instance, knew what they're in for when the Cold War got started. I don't think they had a clue that it would last for 50 years and that all of the troubles that went with it would come. And probably their government didn't know it. But the truth of the matter is that it would have been well, and ultimately, I think the leadership of the United States didn't do a bad job of educating the American people, in which they had a superb assistant, the Soviet Union. But I think that's a very serious challenge to our leadership, to all the whole political class, and I would say it was a challenge to the media, who are such an important part of the transmission, if I thought there was any point, because I think they have no idea of what they're doing, so that they will flunk that challenge for sure.
Thank you. Before we go to questions, I would just like to give the panelists an opportunity, if they wish to take it, to comment on what each of the rest of them have said. So just a few moments on that. Ellen, would you like to?
Actually, I want to ask a question, so
please,
I'll get my question in. And not surprisingly, it's Professor Hill, because I agree with you, and you know that I agree with you, that one of the biggest sort of challenges, and actually, in my opinion, opportunities after the end of the war on Iraq, is the opportunity to try to make some real progress in terms of the Palestinian-Israeli situation. My concern is that the U.S. is not actually sort of, it's going to have to basically put a lot behind that. That's actually going to be a large investment in terms of both political pressure as well as sort of actual sort of funds. And my question is, do we have any great hopes from more of an insider's point of view that that's actually sort of in the works, shall we say?
Yes, I think that we will see that attention very quickly turns, the spotlight will turn to the Israeli-Palestinian negotiation. And it really, if you're watching this from a certain angle, has been doing so since last July. And two things happened about at that time. One was that the Israeli drive into the the camps, into the cities, territories that they had left under Oslo, they went back into those areas to hit terrorist cells, and they did a lot of damage to the terrorist cells. The issue there was that the terrorists had taken over the Palestinian movement, its cause, going back to September of 2000, following when President Clinton and Prime Minister Barak put forward those very, very far-reaching proposals to Chairman Arafat, and he turned them down. I think he turned them down because he felt the fingers of the terrorists around his throat. And we have seen from that time forward until last summer a terrorism calling the shots for the Palestinians. And what that means is the terrorists say, you cannot sign anything with any Israeli government ever because Israel has no right to exist. So that grip had to be broken, and it was broken late last spring. Following that, President Bush made a statement that got a lot of attention in the Palestinian movement, that Palestinians have a right to self-government, and good self-government, and democratic government. And that brought forward, I think, the start of a movement that you can see with responsible people that have come forward in most recent days, the establishment of a prime ministry for the Palestinians that looks as though it actually has some authority behind it that is in some sense independent of Mr. Arafat, and with someone that we know to be a very responsible and mature, serious person that we have dealt with for some time, and that is Abu Mazen. So I think the whole thing is poised to really make progress, because the key is, can there be a signed agreement between Palestinians and Israelis that the Palestinians will adhere to, that give Israel the right to exist? And will the Arab world back that up? And I think we're all set, right, poised to make that kind of progress once this war is over. But it will never happen as long as Saddam Hussein is in charge of Iraq.
Other comments on each other?
Well, is it totally out of bounds, Chairman, to ask the Chairman if anything in the past week has surprised him?
I think what has surprised me is, again, following what Don was saying, the military deployments. I would have expected a somewhat more cautious approach in this regard. And it seems to me this is a high-risk military strategy, which is overlain on a high-risk political strategy, which is the assumption that we are going to be cheered and not shot at. And it does seem to me that we see some fundamental rethinking, because a couple of basic premises with which it seems to me the administration went into this have been disproven in this first week. Doesn't mean that it's a disaster, doesn't mean that the whole thing is going to fail, but it certainly does mean there's going to have to be some, and is taking place, there has happened some serious rethinking, I think, along those lines. Any other comments? Should we go to questions? Okay. Let me just make a quick comment about comments and questions. It's actually a comment about punctuation. Questions are not supposed to end with periods, or with ellipses, or with dashes, or with particularly multiple explanation points. Questions are supposed to end with question marks like that. And I'm going to enforce a fairly rigorous rule tonight because there are so many of you, and I want to allow as much time as possible for as many people as possible to ask questions. So I'm going to ask you to keep your question within a 1 minute limit so that we can have maximum time for as many of these as possible. The floor is open. Microphones in the aisles. Please go to the microphones so that we can all hear you. Yes. Please could you also indicate if your question is directed at some particular member of the panel, would you specify that, please?
My question is openly directed. What I want to know is if any of you have any comments about all the talk about going into Iraq because of the threat of weapons of mass destruction or nuclear weapons. You guys didn't really talk about it, and I want to know if you really think that that's why we're going, or if we're going because of this vaguer threat to the international system, as we know.
Please.
I think in the first instance, it certainly is the weapons of mass destruction. The larger, broader, wider, long-term issue is greater than that because it goes far beyond Iraq. But the case for military action is a completely standalone case. And you don't have to talk about preemption or the Bush Doctrine or anything but the case that is based upon the UN Security Council resolutions, the 17 of them going back to 678. And it was very significant that President Bush, when he made his statement of a week ago Monday that started this campaign, giving Saddam Hussein 48 hours to leave the country, said that we are basing our action on resolution 678 and 687. Those are the original authorizations for the use of military force to go after Saddam Hussein to force him to comply to disarm. And that's the reason, because that's the threat. And there is no one in the former inspection corps, in the present inspection corps, even among the Europeans, even among the French, the Germans, the Russians, I know of no one except Saddam Hussein's own circle, and up to a certain point, Scott Ritter, who has ever said that he has no weapons of mass destruction. So that's the cause here.
Professor Kennedy.
I agree with Professor Hill about the previous UN resolutions and the validity it gives to the United States, should it wish to claim the validity, and clearly that's what the White House is doing. But here's a rub, here's a twofold problem. One is, it's been surprisingly hard to find these weapons of mass destruction, even when we're 220 miles into the country. We have search teams, SWAT teams, special groups waiting to find them. We want to get this evidence on the table. It would be incredibly important politically to come around and send this big package called Weapons of Mass Destruction, put it in the US mail and send it to the Elysee Palace and say, look, we told you so. But we're having difficulty doing that. And the second difficulty is one which is everyone is aware of, and I think sometimes feels their intelligence is insulted by, namely the weapons of mass destruction that certain other rogue states in the world possess, which is not exercising us, is not getting the White House hot under the collar. In fact, it's causing the White House to say, well, let's just calm it down and deal with these Korean boyos in a different way. So there's a kind of inconsistency attached to the weapons of mass destruction argument at the moment.
President Kennedy's comment reminded me of some of my worst years at Yale when I felt I was asked to serve on the executive committee of Yale College, which is, as most of you would have no reason to know, the disciplinary committee of Yale College. And when we would always hear some of my colleagues say at one point when some miscreant whose sins and crimes had been laid out unmistakably on the table, ah, yes, well, no doubt he did that. But there must have been 20 others who did that. How can we act against this one if we don't act against the other 20? I know that's not exactly what Professor Kennedy said, but there was a hint. There was a hint in there. The other point I simply want to make is, he's quite right. It would be wonderful if somebody came out with a bucket of tremendously horrible mass destruction found someplace in there. Okay. in Iraq. But that wouldn't matter, it seems to me, in deciding whether or not the United States was justified in taking the action, because they didn't have that when they made the decision. I think you'd have to look at the question, what would a reasonable person conclude about the situation on the evidence that was available to everybody? Well, Charlie Hill has told you the central fact. Even Mr. Blix, who I like to call Mr. Blind sometimes, because only he could fail to see what's there to see. But that even he has made it very clear that at one point, you know, when he was in his earlier days before 91, he also looked for weapons of mass destruction in there and gave a report saying there weren't any. And then, what do you know, after the war against Saddam the first time, they turned up evidence that he did have these things. Well, what I'm trying to say is that the evidence was such as to make it absolutely unreasonable to doubt that there was a high risk and that one had to act on that basis. Even if we find them now, that won't make our previous decision better or worse. It was either right or wrong.
Professor Lust-Okar.
Yeah, I'd like to add one thing, which was sort of alluded to in Professor Hill's remarks, but there's two issues on the table here. One is it justified or is it legitimate? And the other is that the reason why we're going sort of through this? And I think that there's no question that it's justified and legitimate in terms of sort of the UN resolutions, or at least we can argue that it is. The reason why we're doing it, I think, is a harder thing to say. It's simply the weapons of mass destruction. And if it was, imagine, it's hard to understand why this great split between the U.S. and many of the other powers on this. I think that really comes through because of our interest in sort of, at least among some of the administration, of really remaking the Middle East. I mean, that idea is out there. And this idea that you take care of Iraq and then you can take care of the Palestinian situation and then you can take care of the rest of the region in many ways. And I'm not arguing against that idea at the moment, but I'm simply saying that's another underlying notion, and a notion with which many of the European forces were not particularly excited about our role in doing that. And so that helps to explain this divide between the United States and many of the other powers.
Okay, good. Yes, please.
My question is not directed to anyone in particular. President Bush has stated that one of the outcomes to be expected from this war is this introduction of democracy into the Arab world. I'm a citizen of Saudi Arabia, and I'm part of a very small minority group that believe that democracy is a good thing and that we're trying to implement it in the country. However, I don't know anyone of that group that believe that the war is a good thing. With that in mind, I'm just asking if the dictators that rule us are against democracy, the regular person of the street has been radicalized by this war, whether religiously or nationally. And those who support democracy have been alienated by this war. In your opinion, who do you think is going to help the U.S. promote democracy in the Arab world? Thank you.
Please.
I think that the people of the Middle East will help promote democracy in that part of the world, whether they like the war or not. If they have the opportunity to do so, they will turn toward some form of self-governance. I think that it's not that the U.S. thinks that there's going to be democracy suddenly there throughout the region, by no means. If you go back again to, I think, this very important U.N. report, the Arab Human Development Report, with all of the terrible range of things that it points to, the one point that is underlying them all is the lack of good governance everywhere. And if you look at the troubles that those regimes feel, the fears they have for themselves, the troubles that are inflicted upon their peoples, the sources of terrorism, I think you can all bring it back to bad governance. And what the U.S. hopes to do is simply free the region from at least one tyrant and let those energies come forward for movement of reform and good governance. It's not going to be democracy. Democracy is a tough thing to get to. Maybe it will be in the farther future. But even when you get in Saudi Arabia, this idea put forward by the Saudi government that they are thinking of elections. Elections are not going to be enough to make democracy, but they are thinking of elections, and as part of that, the U.S. should take its troops out of Saudi Arabia. That's a reasonable, that's a matter of some hope. So I put the answer to your question on the shoulders of the Arab people themselves.
Professor Kennedy.
Well, Ellen and I have just been doing a rough figures. It might not be perfect, but here's a horrible thought. We conquer Iraq, we introduce democracy, we get United Nations election inspectors, as we have done very successfully in East Timor and Namibia and Cambodia, etc. But these blessed people, instead of voting for, you know, Republicans and Democrats or conservatives and Labour and Liberal, it so happens that like 20% of them who are Kurd vote for Kurds, and close to 30% who are Sunni vote for Sunni, and 50 to 55% who are Shia vote for Shiites. And the consequence of this is that with hopes aroused by the promise of freedom and liberation and being able to control one's own destiny, you actually find that the majority doesn't treat the minorities with all the consideration that would happen in a mature democracy. So we have, we might be fooling ourselves if we think that the introduction of that golden word democracy would lead in societies which have such long-standing feuds, dislikes, and lack of the open transforming process to pursue just a reasonable parliamentary regime.
Professor Kagan.
I think it's absolutely right that the risks that Professor Kennedy mentions are there, and the problems of democracy, if should any form of it ever emerge, will not be zero. It's not a magic elixir. It is just something that I think most of us feel, given a chance, we'll do better than other prospects, but it's a real difficulty. But compared to what are these dangers that might be created, this Pandora's box we will open up if we put down tyranny and try to establish some form of consensual government in the Middle East? I mean, it will be obviously dreadfully worse than the paradise that now exists in the Middle East.
All right, thanks. Michael.
This is a question for everybody. Professor Hill said the UN has disgraced itself. Respectfully, I think you're wrong. I think the US has disgraced the UN. I look around the world and I see a lot of major international states that are very upset with the US. We've insulted them in the media. We've ridiculed their ministers. We heard some diplomatic words a few minutes ago towards UN weapons inspectors. If diplomacy is the next step, it doesn't seem we have too many people on our side. So it leads me to actually a personal question, a moral question perhaps. Knowing that we may have 50 years of war in front of us, knowing what a quagmire or Pandora's box this all is, why would you argue for a war in your heart of hearts? Why would you want a situation that we acknowledge is going to be this terrible?
Since my comment is actually on the same topic,
okay,
and
ahead.
Then from another aspect, so I
sure.
think I'm going to go on. I strongly disagree with Professor Hill. UN didn't fail to work. On the contrary, it worked effectively because it didn't degenerate into a rubber stamp for the US policy. The Bush administration didn't choose to go through the UN in good faith for a genuine peaceful way to disarm Saddam Hussein. It adopts the preemption doctrine, which necessarily limits the sovereignty of its target countries, while itself will not tolerate any constraints on its own sovereignty, saying the US will not allow others to constrain its freedom of maneuver, including the UN, of course. This is also evidenced by Bush administration's history of scratching a series of treaties even before the happening of 9/11. So this doctrine determines that the Bush administration only wants to use the UN as a rubber stamp for its policy, not the policy of the international community. Therefore, it's not the UN's failure, but it's very success for not having degenerated into a rubber stamp for the U.S. policy, but this success may be the last one if it does not get further U.S. support. My worry is that, my consideration is that, or question for you is that, don't you think that a world ruled by law, including international, of course, international law, is more peaceful and stable? If it is, doesn't the United States have the obligation to obey the laws?
Thanks, Shimon. Two very good questions on the UN and the US role. Who wants to go first? Professor Kennedy.
And then Professor Hill is going to come in and surprising support of what I say.
This is a fix.
Some of you know that Professor Hill and I and a number of our colleagues, Bruce Russert, Jim Sutherland, spent many a year and many gray hairs between 1993 and 1996-97 trying to produce a report for Boutros Ghali and for the Ford Foundation, the Yale Ford report on the long-term future of the UN. So we, and Professor Hill was then policy advisor to Mr. Boutros Ghali for many years, so we have pondered on this one a lot. Just let me make one point. I know that Charlie will respond in a perhaps somewhat different way to me, but there's something about the language we use which is just wrong. When we say the UN has failed, that is incredibly sloppy language. The UN is not a self-standing thing like IBM or something like that. The UN is a group of countries who are major and minor shareholders in a world organization. And it works when the major shareholders work together. And it doesn't work when the major shareholders, for whatever reasons they have, whether in Paris or Washington or Beijing, decide not to work together. To say the United Nations has failed would be like saying the Hamden soccer team has failed. Hamden soccer team failed when some of its major players didn't turn up or performed badly. The Security Council works when, in particular, a pentarchy of five nations who gave themselves certain very special rights at San Francisco in 1945 agree to work together, each protecting the other's rights, aware that compromise is necessary, aware that you're not going to get perfection, but actually thinking back to the lessons of the 1930s, that it's better for the big guys to stay with each other, each with a veto power, than to walk out and bust the system. So when the UN fails, what we really mean is that the major powers have failed to resolve their differences.
Professor Hill.
The UN question, these questions are extremely important, and it's, I think we really need to get a clear view of this, and I think it is clear if it can only be put forward, and I'll try to do that. The way it works in UN Security Council resolution terms, which have the force of international law and are binding upon the members, is that in 1991, the Security Council passed Resolution 678, authorizing the use of force to throw Saddam Hussein's troops out of Kuwait. And that was done by the campaign known as Desert Storm. When that was over, the UN put in place a ceasefire. And then it passed Resolution 687, sort of the twin of 678. And it said that Saddam Hussein's possession of weapons of mass destruction was a threat to international peace and security, and that he must come forward, take the initiative, be proactive, bring forward these weapons, destroy them, and then permit inspectors to look over the destruction, to monitor it, and to certify that it had been done. And that if he did that, then the ceasefire would become permanent, there would be a peace, and the authorization for the use of force would be terminated. But if he did not do that, if he was deceptive, if he was not cooperative, then the ceasefire would lapse. And the original authorization for the use of force in 678 would be reawakened. And in 1991, Saddam Hussein was given 30 days to do this. He did not do it. Inspections began. And I think you probably know most of the story through the years of the 1990s. It came to the point of 1998. Saddam, by that time, had thrown the inspectors out. He had defied the UN in every regard. President Clinton went to the Pentagon in February of 1998 and gave a very definitive speech saying Saddam Hussein has got to go. This caused great concern. The Secretary General flew to Baghdad. He negotiated a memorandum of understanding, came back and said, I have here the commitment of Saddam Hussein now finally to cooperate. Saddam Hussein did not do so. By September, by October, he was in full violation. There were no inspections. Ambassador Richard Butler notified the Security Council that he was not cooperating in any regard. The Security Council passed Resolution 1205, which declared Saddam Hussein to be in flagrant violation of all resolutions. That did the job. That terminated the ceasefire. That reawakened 678. Force was then authorized to be used against Saddam Hussein. President Clinton then did so. He launched the operation called Desert Fox, a major military attack on Saddam Hussein. That operation went on for 4 days and was called off by President Clinton because he was then facing impeachment for the Lewinsky affair. From that time until the campaign of 2000, nothing was done of any note. Saddam Hussein was free to go forward with his plans. But all through that time, everyone involved with the UN, involved with the inspectors, knew that it had to go back to where it was. We could not let it stay there. And in the campaign for the presidency in 2000, both candidates, Vice President Gore and Governor Bush, said that we must get back to this situation and that Saddam Hussein would have to go. And that has been the position of this administration since the very first days. The first thing that President Bush did in January of 2001 was send Vice President Cheney to the Middle East to consult with the countries there about the question of how to force Saddam Hussein to disarm. Last September, the U.S. began by going to the Security Council, the longest, most intensive, most committed effort diplomatically ever put forward at the Security Council by any nation in the history of the United Nations. It's never been done before. There never has been an issue like this in the hands of the Security Council. There never has been a country that has gone so far to try to make those resolutions work. The resolutions are very clear. Saddam Hussein must take the initiative. We did not, because of what I've just described, need another resolution. But those at the Security Council said, yes, let's have another resolution. And so we achieved Resolution 1441 of November of last year, a very good resolution. It reaffirmed in every regard all of the resolutions before, going back to 1991. And it simply said, we give Saddam Hussein one final chance. And the one final chance was to be revealed by the report that he was to issue following that resolution, which he did on December the 8th. A totally, completely, obviously fraudulent report. At that point, there was no need to do any more. But because of the urgings of our friends, we then went forward further. We went all the way up to what you have been watching very closely in these recent weeks, until it came to the point where the French said their position was, Saddam Hussein is now showing signs of some cooperation. And he's doing this because there are 250,000 American troops poised to strike against him. Just keep them poised. And we'll let you know at some indeterminate point in the far future when you can go home or go into action. This is putting American forces under the control of the French. It is also obviously militarily, financially, and politically impossible. Therefore, we knew at that point that the time had come that war was the last resort.
Thank you. Before I take the next question, let me simply observe that the people on this side of the aisle are sitting down and the people on that side of the aisle are standing up. So I think if you guys would like to be more comfortable and sit down, that would be fine over there. We will take them in this order. Next question is over on this side, please. Yes.
Just to go further on the UN and the failure, the correct definition, I think diplomacy in the UN failed. There are many reasons why in the United States, to go further on the correct term of 50-50, who oppose the war and who are for the war. So I don't think you can say that the world, or the United States, is 50-50 on that matter correctly either. There's many reasons why I oppose the war. And one is which, that leading up in the UN, was it not the United States who drafted these resolutions, who maybe economically and politically strong-armed the Securities Council and the UN and such, because it is the biggest player? That's my question.
All right. Answer? Comments?
Well, it's just the old, point. If the UN, if the U.S. does not involve itself, then the U.S. is spurning the UN, and when it does involve itself, then it's said to be dictating to the UN.
Thank you. Question.
Good evening. The reason I would support a war in Iraq would be if we were fighting terrorism. That seems to be the reason we got into this whole mess in the first place. However, I seriously doubt the consequences of winning a war in Iraq versus what that will mean for the rest of the world and America's relations with the rest of the world and recruiting more terrorists, frankly, since they are the ones that are a threat to us, more so than the invisible nuclear weapons, or even if there are them. I believe that the consequences need to be weighed, and I'd like to know what you feel about that, winning a war in Iraq versus what that actually means for terrorism, which is the real threat.
Okay, thanks. Professor Kagan.
I think that's a very sound question. I think one does have to think about that. I think it's a mistake, though, to think that these are separate entities. Well, they are separate, but to miss the point that they have some connections, even though they're two different things. Saddam Hussein, to begin with, what is perfectly clear is if you take terrorism in the largest sense and you don't limit it to al-Qaeda, there is no doubt that Saddam is a supporter of terrorism. He brags about it. He gives bonuses to terrorists who blow themselves up and kill a lot of people at the same time. So he is himself, without question, by his own admission, by his own boasting, a supporter of terrorism. There is also a considerable amount of evidence that is not in that category that I think a fair person would say gives a very good indication that he has given and continues to give further support for terrorism, and here I'm thinking about of the al-Qaeda sort as well. For instance, there is no doubt that there is a very well-established al-Qaeda official who's been living in northern Iraq for some time. So that there's that sort of thing. And then there are even less clearly defined bits of evidence that some people find persuasive and some not, about his having, in fact, engaged in conversation, his people having engaged in conversations in Czechoslovakia with the al-Qaeda people who actually did the blowing up of buildings in New York and Washington. So that's part of the story. I think one would have to be very, very trusting to think this man is probably not engaged in assisting terrorism. But I think there's another side to it. You rightly raise the danger of having a situation in which the United States is seen to be hostile to Arabs, seen to be hostile to Muslims, and that, of course, since the terrorists are all Muslims, the danger that they will be able to recruit more angry Muslims. That's a very real problem. My own opinion is that the world, even before this war, was filled with sufficient angry Muslims to take care of all the Al-Qaeda forces that might be necessary for the purpose. I don't really think this is going to change the situation very materially in that direction, but of course, I could be wrong. What I think we are underestimating, though, is that people, we call them terrorists, but of course they don't think they're terrorists. They think they're freedom fighters or fighters for the glory of God and all of that stuff. And they are like other, and I use the word fanatical, I don't mean to say that in a pejorative sense. There are all kinds of fanatics that I happen to agree with, Yankee fans, for instance. But I mean, joking aside, you know, they are powerfully, fanatically committed to their cause. And history is filled with times when people had this thing. What changes that? Well, sometimes circumstances that nobody can do anything about changes. But another thing I think that demonstrably has had an effect at times in the past is a sense that it's not working, that all the devices that these guys that we call terrorists are using to achieve their goals, to return the world to the Middle Ages as they remember them in the good old days, it's not working. And then people get discouraged, and they turn their mind to other things. It doesn't happen overnight. There's no single action that does it. But there's a change in the sense of the course of events, and people adjust. I mean, one example that you all know perfectly well because you've all studied it occurred in the Peloponnesian War, when democracy, which had been a rising force in the Greek world because of Athens' enormous increase in power and influence, it turned right around when the Spartans won a big victory at Mantinea, and from that day forward, oligarchy crept up and democracy went down. That's just one example. There are others. What I'm suggesting, and there's no guarantee of any kind about this, one way to deal with this problem, and I can't be sure it's not the best way, would be to be resolute, to defeat terrorism and its advocates and its supporters every way that we can in a prudent manner, and hope that this will have a discouraging effect and lead people to try to achieve goals that are reasonable in some different way.
Thanks, Professor Lust-Okar.
Yeah, actually, I want to, if I understand your question correctly, you're actually talking about sort of two sets of actors that you think they were sort of moving away from, right? One is the Europeans, and one is this question of sort of the Arabs in the region. And I'd like to, a point of clarification, which is, of course, that not all of the terrorists are Muslim, either in the Middle East or actually sort of in the larger sphere of sort of who's used terrorism. And, of course, that's a definition that is debatable. But I think it's important to sort of take a step back and place this within the context of sort of this question of the New World Order. Because some of the things that have been raised, you know, this issue of, you know, do you in the heart of hearts want to see a war, by the way, and just so it's really clear, my answer is no, okay? But also, do you necessarily think that this is going to sort of increase terrorism or increase sort of our distance from the Europeans? It's not clear to me that given sort of the position that we found ourselves in, especially after 9/11, and I'm not arguing, I don't think there's a very good evidence that there's a link between Saddam Hussein and Iraq and terrorists, but rather I think what sort of became clear to the administration were two things. One is that we really do have a preponderance of power, and that basically sort of the idea was that we're going to reshape this. We've been talking for a decade about the New World Order, and this is a time to sort of reshape it. So this question about what's the UN role and sort of, you know, are we all essentially sort of willing to work together, all of a sudden the constraints on the US were weakened considerably. And it's not clear to me that the US doesn't see itself as possibly gaining in the long run from that. I'm not saying it's going to, I'm just saying that that's one perception of it, okay? Similarly, with regards to the Arab states and terrorism, I think this is an incredibly high-risk strategy, but one could argue that what we looked around and saw was things like the UNDP sort of, you know, report that demonstrates the extent to which there is sort of widespread poverty and a lack of sort of, you know, good life in the Arab world, that the regime's elites had been very closely tied, or at least perceived to be very closely tied to the U.S., okay? And that one of the reasons that we were starting to see terrorism, and also that we were starting to see terrorism against the U.S., was because of this link between the United States and repressive regimes in the region. It's a catch-22. It's a very difficult situation to sort of extract yourself from. and one way to extract yourself from it, although it's, again, an incredibly high-risk strategy, is to essentially say, okay, we're going to change this world order. We're going to try to, we're even willing to sort of see shifts in the elites in this region. We're willing to see shifts in the leadership. We're now calling democratization, although nobody's quite sure if we can get democracy or not get democracy. And certainly, if you can get democracy within the limits of what the U.S. would like to see it look like, right? But I think that there was an analysis made that basically said, look, we can go down the road we're going down, which is to continue to see poverty, sort of a dispossessed and unhappy people, the lack of solving the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, and an inability to sort of have leaders who are seen as legitimate and are seen as being supported by the U.S. And in the long run, that's going to be a disaster and only promote more terrorism. Or we can take this other strategy, which you're absolutely right, may also promote sort of, again, intense dislike and distrust from the U.S. because it's a risky and very difficult at best strategy to try to sort of promote democracy and have intervention and yet not be seen as controlling the region.
Okay. On that optimistic note, next question, please.
Hi there. I'm by no means a hawk on the war. However, I've noticed something in the past week or so that's been increasingly dismaying to me. It seems to me that many people are criticizing the United States and Britain for assembling a coalition of weak countries to support them in the war. From my viewpoint, it seems like they are criticizing the most powerful country in the world as countries that are less powerful than it, or getting the support and gaining the support of countries which are less powerful than they are. Is this not the same sort of might makes right power politics for which the United States has been so roundly criticized by other nations in the world? Are the French, the Russians, and Professor Kennedy
right in there with the French and the Russians.
Not speaking somewhat hypocritically when they criticize the United States for seeking broader support in the international arena from smaller countries.
Professor Kennedy.
Well, speaking on behalf of my friends, Mr. Putin and Chirac, I think that what we had was something which seems to me absolutely normal, and I'm sure Professor Hill will come in and confirm this. A future resolution or a future decision of the Security Council could pass or fail depending upon the votes or the veto of the five permanent members or just a straight majority of the members, 9 out of 15, therefore including 10 rotating two-year members. And the rotating two-year members were, if you like, fair game for both the French and the Russians to put pressure upon them and for the Americans and the British. I talked with our good friend Professor Zedillo about a couple of weeks ago, and I said, Ernesto, the Mexican foreign ministry must be very happy that it's a member of the Security Council at this time, and he shook his head and said, no. The pressure was coming from both sides. It was coming from powerful nations. The French were sending their minister to Angola and elsewhere, no doubt offering them bribes. We were offering them Lord knows what sort of incentives to vote. If it had gone to a General Assembly vote, we would all be going around trying to pack that larger grouping. And that's in the nature of the voting system. And the small powers decided in different ways according to their interest. I don't think there's anything new happened in that story.
This is really interesting stuff, and we, you know, you can argue it, I think, any number of ways. It's politics. It's world politics. And I think maybe one of the most far-reaching developments to come out of this recent episode at the UN is what has happened to the European Union. Because there you had the French and the Germans clearly in a power play to use this case, to use the Iraq case for European Union politics, to turn themselves, should they succeed, into something like a Security Council for the EU. so that when the EU faces a major security issue in the future, you normally naturally turn to the French and the Germans to solve it for you and leave the others out of it. And that didn't work. The French split the EU. And the smaller and weaker and newer members balked. And they came over to the side of the US. So that 18, suddenly within the space of about 5 days, there were 18 European countries signing up, literally signing up with the US position as against the French position. Now that's something you can assess from the point of view of the Iraq issue, but in terms of European Union politics, that's big stuff. I think it will never quite be the same because the EU, the smaller, weaker EU members or aspirant members essentially called in the US as a balance of power factor here to help them. So they saw this as something that served their interest as against the bigger powers next door to them.
Yes.
I believe your question had a part of it about big power arrogance and bullying. And I just want to at least throw this in that President Chirac, of course, who is appalled by the United States throwing its weight about and being so arrogant and bullying everybody, said to those Eastern European nations who had the gall to disagree with Gaul that they missed a wonderful opportunity to keep their mouths shut.
Over here. Next question, please.
Hi. This is not directed toward anybody in particular. One of America's chief reasons, or at least stated reasons, for going to war with Iraq has been that of championing democracy, rule of the people. If, however, we took a world vote, that is, we took the 75% of Americans who support the war, and we also took the 60% of British who are against it, the 90% of French who are against it, 99% of Arabs who are against it, the 70% of Japanese who are against it. I haven't seen any numbers coming out of China recently, but I don't know about that. If, however, some pollster did take all those votes, I submit they would find that world opinion is strongly against war in Iraq. This then leads to one of two conclusions, either that democracy is a flawed institution or that the U.S. shouldn't be going to war with Iraq. Which one?
If I could just add a follow-on to that using my moderator's prerogative. One of the things that's been quite striking about the succession of events over the last year and a half is how we started out in the days after 9/11 with almost a unanimously shared sense of threat, even the French. Shared this sense of threat. We are all Americans now, they said. Somehow, over the last year and a half, this has fragmented. The sense of shared threat has somehow broken into a series of differently perceived threats. And it seems to me historians looking back on this period from some distance into the future are going to say this has been one of the most remarkable aspects of it, this astonishing shared sense of threat fragmenting into such a fragmented and dissonant sense of threat. So I wonder if I could just add on to your question with your permission and ask our panelists to comment on this. I think it's a big issue. Professor Kagan.
Well, I don't think we should confuse democracy, which ought to be a functioning political system that has safeguards against the worst kind of inanity once in a while, with polls, which is really what you're talking about. Now, I just a couple more things to say about that. First of all, polls change constantly for reasons that are not always understandable. But perhaps you saw what I saw, which was that not very long ago, I'm talking about a matter of days, in Britain and in Australia, where the polls were showing hostility to the war by a majority of the people. Suddenly, a majority began to be in favor of the war. That's the nature of these things. Secondly, here's another one for you. I believe that if you had taken a poll of Europeans in 1937, 1938, as to whether they should contemplate fighting a war to stop Hitler, you would have had an overwhelming vote against such a proposition. There's nothing surprising about any of that. Now, John's question is more interesting, having to do with the, well, only because it's more specific to our situation, I think. Why in this particular situation was there such a change in the apparent public opinion about the United States and its problems? I think part of the answer was, again, the polls, which is what you're talking about, right after the attack on the United States, naturally provoked a kind of sympathy that would have been really surprising if it had been totally missing. But that concealed quite a lot of mistrust, quite a lot of anxiety, quite a lot of envy, quite a lot of dislike that was under the skin a certain distance. But the truth of the matter is that this was played upon very deliberately and very skillfully by the leadership of the two countries that have led the anti-American drive in Europe, by Chirac and Schroeder. Schroeder, who was not particularly hostile to America until he saw the polls, which showed that he was going to lose the election because his extreme left was very anti-American, and he wasn't sufficiently anti-American, so he came out against America, and suddenly he won the election. In the case of Chirac, the story is more complicated. But none of this is very shocking, and I don't think any of us should be unduly swayed one way or another. If tomorrow everybody said, what we're doing is wonderful, we should be just as thoughtful about what we're doing.
Professor Lust-Okar.
Yeah, I think the cautionary note on polling is actually well taken. On the other hand, I also think that sort of this is maybe what we're thinking of in terms of democracy, when if it works out through democratic means the way we want it, it's a good thing, and if it doesn't, then, you know, then we can sort of skip over it at that point in time. And that's actually, frankly, my fear for the kind of democracy we're talking about in the region afterwards. On to the question about sort of, you know, what happened to this kind of consensus on threat. And I'm actually not sure we lost the consensus on threat. It's not clear to me that in the end of the day that the debate has been over whether or not Saddam is a bad man and there's weapons of mass destruction, but rather about what are the consequences of the actions we take, and again, particularly with regards to sort of the international system as a larger system. And that seems to me that's where we broke sort of ranks with many of the European forces, not in the question of whether or not there's a threat out there, or we're all fearful of it, or whether or not Saddam Hussein needs to be contained. It was a question of how to do it.
Professor Kennedy.
This is a really important question, but how one answers it in a minute is rather difficult. Look, the international system and the UN system is not a universal plebiscite, so it doesn't say very much to say that the public opinion poll in Japan has 55% against and in Germany 75%. The international system consists of 190 sovereign states who've agreed to sink certain of their privileges and powers in the United Nations system, and to recognize that five of the countries have particular privileges, especially of a negative nature. In a way, I would have thought in some regards, democracy has been seen to be working very well in the past crisis. All right, Schroeder saw the polls, but he decided to go in the way politicians do when they see polls. That's a perfectly democratic way of going on. The best example of where I think democracy has been working in this crisis has actually been in the House of Commons. Just to watch Tony Blair go week after week after week to votes of no confidence or challenges, and to argue it out. Last Tuesday was a 10-hour-long debate. That was a sight more democratic than we have somewhere on the Hill down in Washington. But it works, but it works in imperfect ways, because the 1945 system was very definitely an imperfect system. I don't know how we would build a United Nations now if we had to start from scratch, quite frankly. But let me say one other thing about the perceptions, the question that Professor Gaddis asked. It is a truly important issue that he raises of having what looked like manifestations of pretty well all the world's sympathy and good wishes a year and a half ago, and that slowly evaporating. Now, it doesn't seem to me to make much use to
try to finger point and say what was it that caused it. I spent 10 years of my feckless youth writing a book called The Rise of the Anglo-German Antagonism. Why did the Germans and the British, who for many years were very friendly, why did, after 50 years, they come to suspect each other? And I realized that at the end of the day, it wasn't my job to say it was the Germans' fault or the Kaiser's fault or Edward Grey's fault. The fact was that a set of perceptions and misperceptions evolved, and a set of perceptions and misperceptions about the United States and about how it uses its power or misuses its power now exists as a historical fact, whether or not you're going to come down in judgment as to is most of the blame on one side of the Atlantic or not on the other, on the other side of the Atlantic.
Okay.
Damn good book.
He's going to be on the blurb of my next edition.
At this point, let me raise a procedural question. It is now 20 minutes till 10, and as a courtesy to our panel members, some of whom may need to rush home to be consulted urgently by the White House or the National Security Council, who knows, maybe I could get a fix from the four of you as to whether we could go for another maybe 15 minutes or so. Would that be all right? Yes?
You're pushing it, John.
Okay.
ten.
All right, we're gonna try to cut it off in 10 to 15 minutes, which means that questions henceforth must be even briefer than they have been, and answers henceforth should also be briefer than they have been. Yes, next.
I'd welcome responses from any of the panelists. We've heard a lot of reasons from the Bush administration justifying the war. First, it was their links to terrorist organizations, which sort of shakily proven. Then it became, we want to get Saddam's weapons of mass destruction, and the latest mutation is Operation Iraqi Freedom, liberate the Iraqi people by dropping bombs on them. But something we don't hear that much about from the administration is that members of the Bush administration have ties to the oil industry in the United States. Bush, for example, Vice President Cheney, of course, was the CEO of Halliburton before he became the vice president. And Halliburton, as Professor Kennedy mentioned, has been awarded contracts for rebuilding the oil wells in Iraq. And if you listen very carefully, you heard President Bush warn the Iraqi people that destroying oil wells would actually be considered a war crime. So I'd just like to hear if any of you think we would be doing this war in Iraq if Iraq didn't have 200 some billion gallons or barrels of oil underneath its sand.
Okay, please.
Well, I just can't resist giving you a little piece of autobiography very briefly, John, and that is, it's wonderful to see the great oil ogre appear again. When I was a teenager and the Korean War broke out, my friends explained to me the war was about trying to get to save MacArthur's oil wells in Korea. And then when the Vietnam War broke out, it was the oil of Southeast Asia that the United States was attempting to acquire. I'm not making that up. Those were really meant as serious claims. Well, of course, Iraq really does have oil, and a hell of a lot of it. And we certainly do care about that. There's no question that Iraq would not be a serious problem to us if Iraq did not have a very great amount of oil. But the reasons, it seems to me, are only the assumptions, I think, behind the question, as there are these economic purposes, either by malefactors of great wealth in our government or just by the country in terms of its own economic interest. No, I think the economic significance has to do with the strategic importance of the kind, first of all, of the capacity to control the oil supply and use it in the world of power politics, which has been done frequently in the past. And the second is to use the incredible revenues available from oil to build military power that would have been inconceivable for a country like Iraq. It would not be bad for Iraq to have as much oil as it has and to use it any way it like if it wasn't run by this dangerous, aggressive, murderous dictator. So I think oil is important, but in that respect.
Okay, Professor Kennedy.
Oh, you know, if any of you are misguided enough to be led astray by Professor Gaddis and Kagan and end up as doing history PhDs and then become history professors and in 30 years' time are teaching and researching the origins of this present war in the way we teach and research the origins of the Second World War, the Korean War, you can sure as heck bet there'll be some historians who say it was economic motivations which drove it, some of whom said it was really a president with a sense of mission, a sense of drive, some of whom will say it was to do with worries about Israel, some of the interpretations will be about the military-industrial complex. We'll see the whole lot of it, so it's fair game for you to put it on the table now. It will be on the table in 30 and 50 years' time. That's what gives us historians a job. There's got to be 7 or 8 or 9 competing reasons for every war, and then we teach it term after term after term.
You're surely right,
Professor Lust-Okar.
Yeah, actually, I would say that it's important to think not only sort of about whether or not Iraq has oil, but whether the region has oil. And of course, that is interesting, that not only is the strategic importance of the region for oil is combined with Israel, so there's actually the sort of an economies of scale, if you will, in terms of thinking about having a significant influence or control over the region. And so I would doubt that it is one or the other. It's this notion that these two things have come together in this particular region, and if Iraq per se had oil or didn't have oil, my hunch is it wouldn't really matter. What matters is you've got a strong force in a region that's incredibly important to the U.S.
Professor Hill.
I think that if there's one thing we're not doing this for, it's oil, and it's in the record makes it more than totally clear. If we wanted oil, we certainly would have abandoned Israel many, many decades ago. It's Israel's enemies who got the oil. Israel has none. Or we would have behaved in this most recent episode the way the French and the Russians have behaved. They love Saddam Hussein. They'd like to keep him just the way he is because they've got great oil contracts with Saddam Hussein. And finally, we would not be doing what we have been doing now going back quite a few years, and that is making sure that the oil in that area, going back to the Oil for Food program, which I was part of helping to negotiate at the UN, is put into international trust. And the way that works is, and the way we're talking about it now, very clearly is being structured so that it would be simply impossible for the U.S. to touch Iraq's oil. That oil will go to the Iraqi people.
Okay. Question.
It's my understanding that in Afghanistan, that President Bush had not intended initially to give much aid to Afghanistan this past year, and I wanted to question what you thought, what sort of message that sends to people and what kind of implications that has for the situation in Iraq. Because in my opinion, the only way to in any way justify this war is to at least bring that stability to the region, and there's no way we can do that without enormous economic influence and investment in the region and in Iraq.
Okay. Please.
I think that the thrust of the remark is probably not right on target. I think that there is nation building. That's something that the Republican Party certainly turned against. It was a bad word in the 1990s. Senator Dole ran on it, essentially, but that's changed. And what's taking place in Afghanistan is what I think will and should take place in Iraq, and that is a multilateral, multinational effort. There's a lot of money being pledged, not enough. It's not what we want, but we're trying to get more, and it's going to Afghanistan, and we have, in fact, look at our adversaries in a way diplomatically over this most recent event. We have the Germans in charge of peacekeeping forces in Afghanistan, and we have the French in charge of training the new Afghan National Army. So there's a lot of assistance going to Afghanistan, and I think it's doing pretty well. We also see there it's not a democracy. It's maybe not even a democratization, but it's sort of democratish. and it's leaning that way, and based upon the cultural heritage of the Afghan people, based on the Loya Jirga. So it's a long, hard road ahead in Afghanistan, but I think it doesn't look bad.
Okay. I'm going to take two more questions, one from over here and one from over here, and then we're going to have to break it up. So last question from this side, please.
All right. I'm an exception to the group of people that President Levin mentioned in the beginning. I was in the war. I was in the Second World War. I enlisted 60 years ago and spent 3 years in the Navy. And when the war, and I was very idealistic and naive and enthusiastic about the war. And when the war was over, I was just sickened by the number of people that I knew who died in that war. And ever since then, I have felt very strongly that it's extremely important for us to do anything that we can to avoid war, whatever it is. I think it takes a lot more courage for this, or would have taken a lot more courage for this country to have pursued some peaceful means to bring about some resolution to what's happening, to what was happening in the Middle East with Iraq. I had a plan. I thought I had a very simple plan about how to handle the situation in Iraq, and that was, it was based on the assumption that Saddam would not be a threat as long as there were inspectors in Iraq. If one accepts that, then I felt that if it took 5 years or 10 years of inspections in Iraq to disarm that man, we should do it. With one difference from the situation that existed before, and that would be for us to get a resolution from the UN commitment to go to war if he kicked the inspectors out. I thought that that sequence of things might have stood a chance of resolving the issue that we were also worried about. But in any event, I think that the harm that is being done in the world, I'm less concerned about some of the things that are happening in other countries. I'm very much concerned about what is happening in this country. I think that we are doing ourselves a great deal more harm in having someone sitting in Washington behaving as if he's God. And for those of you who were here teaching 35 years ago, you know very well he's nothing like that. But for him to make a decision to sink all of us into this conflict and to be responsible for all of the killing that he may not feel very strongly about, but the rest of us do, I think it's just done this country a great deal of harm to be involved in that conflict. There should have been some effort, much stronger efforts made for a peaceful resolution. And I would like to know if any of you thought that that would have been a possibility.
Okay, thank you. Question. Who would like to go first?
Well, two things. That's very close to the position I came to about a month or so ago. One of my monthly op-eds, LA Times, I wrote about why don't we Lilliput Saddam, by which I meant that we would have teams of weapons inspectors, all sorts of inspectors, human rights inspectors, environmental protection, just cross-lacing the country, making it very, very difficult for that regime to move or to do very much. Some of my colleagues didn't think that that was effective or used the argument that, well, we've been doing that, although my argument was that we should be ratcheting it up by tenfold in terms of numbers of inspectors. So I thought it had a chance, but as I said in my very opening remarks, that's water under the bridge now. It hasn't happened. Allow me to say one more thing, though. I really do respect a veteran getting up and saying something, whether in favor or against, and As I've watched particularly desk chair intellectuals and pundits and think tank experts talk about the causes for going to war or not for going to war, I began to think that perhaps one person, one vote is not a very good form of democracy. Here's a proposal for you to take away tonight. I would offer three votes to anyone who was actually in the armed service or had an immediate member of a family in the armed service, your husband, your son. Two votes if, like you, sir, you had served in the armed service, and perhaps half a vote to all of those who are arguing for war but will have no family member or no connection, no one who's going to get hurt by it in any direct sense. And then we might see how the votes pan out. And I would definitely accept a majority vote if it was done by those who are actually going to be fighting or had been experienced in war.
You wouldn't like the outcome of that vote. Paul.
I said I would accept it.
May I?
Yes.
I would just say that I have, just by chance, been reasonably close to a lot of American presidents. I went into the U.S. government in the administration of John F. Kennedy, and I have watched them all, and every one of them, every president, in my view, presidents to come, there is no American president who wants to send American young people into a war. It's the worst possible thing you can do. And every American president agonizes over that and does everything possible to avoid it. And yet, in one way or another, every one of those American presidents did it. And because those presidents did it, we are here and able to talk this way tonight.
Yes, please.
And this comes back to something that was said earlier. I think a lot of people in sort of regards to the kind of proposal you're putting on the table have said, you know, that the basically it was the presence of so many troops in the region that then led to some movement. And I would like to say, I think that in some ways it was the presence of so many troops in the region that basically made it a going to war or going to war choice. I mean, that we had sort of, we tipped the balance or set the hand before we really went to sort of the second UN resolution. So it's not clear to me that we actually gave sort of your kind of plan the chance that it deserved and that actually I think would have worked.
Okay, thanks. Okay. Last question.
About two or three days ago on one of these talking head analyses of the war, Richard Pearl came on, the former, I guess, deputy assistant, the Minister of Defense or something like that, Secretary of Defense, who he seemed to imply that Syria and Iran are possibly next, Iran being number two, I guess, in the axis of evil. And I'm wondering whether, I guess this is an open question to the panelists, whether they think that it's going to happen. How inevitable is it? Is it inevitable at all? I'm sure Professor Kagan has much to say about that. And is this possibly sort of some steps towards some kind of clash of civilizations has been reported by the likes of Mr. Pearl and Mr. Wolfowitz and some of the hawkish neoconservatives in the Bush administration?
Well, you know me well enough that you've predicted my answer and that nothing of that sort is ever inevitable. But I don't even think that's especially likely. I think that if Saddam and his regime are removed from Iraq, I actually hope that it will have a positive effect on the ability of people who want to deal with terrorism to persuade those regimes and others that it's a bit too risky to do that too obviously and too openly and too fully, and that the result will be making the situation a little bit better. But I think there's really next to no prospect that anybody would want to make war about that, particularly since people who know about these things, and I'm not one of them, think that it might be a big mistake to antagonize Iran especially at this point when the Iranians are having so much trouble with their own internal dissenters, that seem to me very imprudent at this point to try to scare the Iranians more than is necessary. I think you want to try to give that situation as much time as possible.
I might just jump into this one, since you raised the question of the clash of civilizations. And I think that there is something very fundamental that's going on here, but it's not Sam Huntington's influence. It's Francis Fukuyama's influence. And it seems to me what is really quite astonishing is that this conservative Republican administration has bought into Fukuyama's theory about the inevitable triumph of democracy. It's even more remarkable that this conservative Republican administration has bought into the intellectual and political legacy of Woodrow Wilson. So there's some very interesting ideological reshufflings going on here. This administration, I believe, believes that there will be a kind of domino theory effect in the Middle East, and that the effect of knocking off Iraq will mean that dominoes will fall elsewhere, democratic dominoes will fall elsewhere, and we won't have to do more than just kind of nudge them. I don't know whether that's right or whether it's wrong, but I think it's a fascinating progression in the intellectual and ideological history of our time that conservative Republicans have indeed come around to this. Some of you will remember a period when conservative Republicans were actually pessimistic about human nature.
Applause for our chairman.
Any other comments?
I actually have one. I want to. I mean, there's two things. One is that we've, in my opinion, just missed an opportunity, and hopefully we'll get it again. That you're right, that the moderates are essentially coming to the fore in Iran. It makes no sense to put pressure on the Iranian regime in a sort of a military sense at this point in time. And I would argue is the same for Syria. Also, when this is sort of when we're done watching live feeds on CNN, we have to remember North Korea is out there. That seems to be a much more important thing to address next than, you know, going after Iran and thinking about Syria.
Yeah.
Okay. Other comments?
Well, look, I debate Richard Perle at Brown University on Tuesday evening. I'll ask him your question, and I'll see if he will confidentially outline his plans for Iran and Syria and everywhere else. And if you can give me your email address, I'll pass on whatever message he brings.
All right. I want to, first of all, once again, thank Rick Levin for having had this excellent idea, to thank the excellent members of the panel for an excellent discussion, and to thank the excellent members of the audience for their excellent questions. We were all excellent tonight.
This is great information.